Tonight, plastic cups on SUNY Oswego's campus are officially banned. More on how students on campus feel about single-use plastics.
The body of a fallen Marine returns home to New York. More on how he contributed to his community.
And an explosion in Sri Lanka leaves hundreds dead. How the United States plans to respond.
WTOP 10 Nightly News starts now.
Good evening and welcome to WTOP 10 Nightly News. I'm Curtis Cady.
And I'm Adrian Shelton.
The death toll from a wave of bombings across Sri Lanka on Easter Sunday increased to nearly 300. No one has claimed responsibility, but authorities have arrested 24 people in connection with the attacks. And now the U.S. is responding and offering support to the people of Sri Lanka.
Both Secretary of State Mike Pompeo and President Donald Trump spoke to Sri Lanka's Prime Minister. The president pledges support to Sri Lanka in bringing the perpetrators to justice, and the leaders reaffirmed their commitment to the fight against global terrorism. At least 290 people were killed Sunday, and at least 500 more were injured. Americans among those killed included a fifth grader from the Washington, D.C. area and Dieter Kowalski from Colorado.
A hot topic on campus, the use of plastics will be reduced by over 300,000 cups. Students were asked to fill out a survey while voting for the Student Association election. 53% of students voted against, 32% to keep, and 15% voted neutral on the referendum. With the help of a ban signed into SA legislation, the campus will no longer have cups in dining halls.
I'm a really big fan of it. I work at the Lakeside Dining Hall, and I see students have those cups on their trays all the time, and most of the time they're using them in the dining hall. So I think like having a ban on them is going to be really impactful for the environment.
In order for us to move towards a carbon neutral campus or to reduce our carbon footprint by 2050, it's going to take sacrifices from all factions of our campus and all factions of our community.
A new project underway in the city of Oswego is likely to attract tourists and bring year-round fun for locals. An indoor water park is part of the 12 projects the city is hoping to complete. The water park will be linked to the Quality Inn and Conference near the Lake Ontario waterfront. Mayor Billy Barlow says the goal of the project is to strengthen the downtown area of Oswego as a family destination. It's estimated the water park will take $4.5 million to build.
An Oswego man is being charged with four Class A misdemeanors in relation to a police chase and vehicle rollover. City police say 31-year-old Eric Christman failed to yield for authorities in the city of Oswego before speeding and committing multiple traffic violations on his way to Scriba. Christman's offenses include criminal possession of a controlled substance, operating a motor vehicle while impaired by drugs, and assault due to injuries other occupants in his vehicle sustained.
We are joined on the desk with reporter Tomas Rodriguez.
Yes, Adrian. University Police Department is conducting a thorough campaign looking for motorists who are unrestrained. Police are looking for violations on campus, although traffic stops may take place off campus.
As part of the nationwide Buckle Up Day and Night campaign, university police will have special patrols out looking for motorists who are not wearing their seatbelts. People not wearing a seatbelt are 30 times more likely to be ejected from a vehicle. Assistant University Police Chief Kevin Belsey has been involved with university police for 30 years.
Well, because we're a police department on a college campus, the majority of our drivers are college age. We do have some older drivers that are employees or some people just passing through campus.
It has been proven that just wearing a seatbelt reduces the risk of death or injury by 50%.
So the crashes have dropped. Our compliance rate is what they also look for in these grant programs has gone way up. When we first started, our compliance rate was about 75%, which means 75% of the people that are required to wear a seatbelt in the front seat of a vehicle, 75% of them were, 25% were not.
Tomas Rodriguez, WTOP 10 Nightly News.
After years of ticketing and educating, the seatbelt compliance rate on campus has gone from 75% up to 93%.
Parishioners attending Easter services at New York's St. Patrick's Cathedral were greeted by extra security. This was the scene Sunday at the cathedral. You can see a large police presence outside as parishioners were entering. New York City police increased security hours after hundreds of people were killed in a series of bombings targeting churches and other sites in Sri Lanka. And a New Jersey man was arrested last week after police say he entered the cathedral with gallons of gasoline, lighter fluid, and lighters.
Interesting, because there was law enforcement everywhere.
Our bags were searched as we entered the cathedral.
Police say the man who entered St. Patrick's Cathedral, 37-year-old Mark Lamparello, faces charges of attempted arson, reckless endangerment, and trespassing. His lawyer says Lamparello is undergoing a psychiatric evaluation and will likely be arraigned next week.
A fallen U.S. Marine who is also a decorated FDNY firefighter was honored Monday in a three-state procession. 43-year-old Staff Sergeant Christopher Slutman was killed April 8th in a roadside bomb attack in Afghanistan. His body was transported from Dover Air Force Base in Delaware to a funeral home in New York City, and firefighters lined the roads as his motorcade passed by. Slutman, a husband and father of three, was a 15-year veteran of the New York City Fire Department. Funeral services are set for Friday.
Police in New York have found a person of interest after two women were attacked with an axe, but they aren't yet releasing a name. 20-year-old Savannah Rivera was found hacked to death in her apartment early Saturday. A second woman who lives there, 21-year-old Angela Vale, was critically injured. A 4-year-old girl found in a separate bedroom was not hurt. Police say they believe the victims knew their attacker. They found an axe in a dumpster nearby, but have not positively identified it as the weapon.
Now let's take a quick look at the weather with Storm Team 10 Chief Meteorologist Alex Bielefeld. Alex, what can we expect out there?
Well, right now we're actually not too bad. Temperatures are in the 40s here in Oswego. Off to our south and east, though, we are a bit warmer here in Oneida Lake. You're at 55. Cleveland, you're at 56. And that's all thanks to Lake Ontario, as that cold water at this time of the year keeps us cooler than what we can get to. Radar and satellite is dry right now, and that's going to continue through tonight. Look at that, by 6 a.m., though, we do have a dry start as we're watching some showers that are going to move into later tomorrow afternoon and into the evening. I'll have more of that coming up after the break, but for now, I'm going to send it back to the desk, guys.
Coming up later tonight, the U.S. is on track to break the number of measles cases since the disease was declared eliminated. More on recent cases reported.
And six people are dead following a plane crash 65 miles north of San Antonio, Texas. What the Department of Safety says about this crash.
This is WTOP 10 Nightly News. We'll be right back.
Josh, the stream's not working. We need you to fix it right now.
The stream's down? I'll be right there.
Oh my God, so you'll never believe what happened to Khloe Kardashian this week.
Oh my God, what happened? Tell me.
Okay, so she was at the mall, shopping at Saks.
Oh, hey, didn't see you there.
Hey, we're practicing for our new show, What's the Tea, starring me.
And me.
Hey, Brianna, when does it air?
Every other Sunday at 10 o'clock.
Oh yeah, I almost forgot.
Anyway, I can't wait for you to sip some tea with us.
Only on WTOP. Cool.
Welcome back from the break, everyone. I'm your chief meteorologist, Alexander Bielfeld. Today, we did start out a bit cloudy, but once those clouds began to break, the sun helped warm us up. We got up to a high temperature of 59 degrees. That is right around average. We're supposed to be right around 60, so a very average day. That sun did feel nice. Currently, right now, across the region, you can see temperatures here in Oswego. We're at 46, and that's thanks to Lake Ontario, as that cool water from Lake Ontario and that onshore breeze keeps us cooler than areas to our south and east. Where look at that, Oneida Lake, you're at 55. Phoenix, you're a bit cooler than that. You're at 49. But zooming out, you can see a general trend of warm temperatures across New York State, all right around average. Rochester, you're at 56. Syracuse, you're a bit below average at 53 degrees. But all in all, today was a pretty quiet and beautiful day. Radar and satellite showing clear skies, and that is going to continue through tonight and into the early part of tomorrow, as we are watching our next storm system to move on in tomorrow afternoon into the evening. We have this storm system off the east coast right now. That's going to continue to push off to the north and east, and that's not going to affect us. But our next storm system moves in tomorrow afternoon and into tomorrow evening. Later tonight, though, you can see temperatures in the 40s around midnight, 47 in Syracuse. That's going to continue with a mix of clouds. And for your morning commute, you can see temperatures starting out into the low 40s and the upper 30s with a mix of sun and clouds. But as we get into Tuesday afternoon, around the 2 o'clock time frame, you can see clouds begin to increase from the west as we have this cold front that begins to approach us from the west. And it's going to bring us for the threat of rain as we get into 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock. We're going to watch for that chance for showers to increase. And that's going to continue through the evening as that cold front continues to approach us from the west. But notice as that cold front pushes by, you can see the temperature really drop down into the 40s. And that's going to continue for tomorrow evening into tomorrow night. To recap it all, you can see tonight's lows were here in Oswego. We're going to be around 40, generally around 40 throughout the entire area. And for tomorrow's highs, actually, we're going to be warming up before that cold front swings on by into the 70s, south and east. Here in Oswego, we're going to be stuck at 60. All because of that Lake Ontario water is much cooler, and being that we are close to the lakeshore, that onshore breeze is going to help keep us cooler than surrounding areas. 7-day forecast, you can see tomorrow we're going to be cooler at 62 degrees, still around average for this time of year, but we do have those showers moving in. Tuesday afternoon into the evening. Wednesday, as that cold front swings by, look at that, only a high of 47, the breezy conditions. Our next chance of rain comes Friday, Saturday, start of the weekend, again cool. Coming up after the break, we have more news and sports. You're watching WTOP 10 Nightly News.
I'm Zachary Haynes. I'm the new host and producer of the new comedy sketch show, Acting Out, a comedy sketch show by college students for college students. You can check us out here on WTOP every other Sunday this semester on B weekends. Okay, I guess B weekends are down here now in the bottom left corner of your screen. Anyways, we got all sorts of great sketch. Okay, guys, what's going on with the set? What's going on?
You made her college years possible, opening that education savings account when she was little, spearheading campus tours, and deciphering financial aid. If you can ace planning for college, you can do it for retirement. Get on track with tips at aceyourretirement.org.
Welcome back to WTOP 10 Nightly News. The U.S. is on track to break the record of measles cases since the disease was declared eliminated. On Monday, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention reported 71 new cases of measles in the U.S. The number of cases this year is now at 626. That's approaching 667 reported in 2014. Iowa and Tennessee are reporting cases for the first time, joining 20 other states, including New York and Washington, which have larger outbreaks. No fatalities have been reported in the United States for measles this year.
Good Samaritans had no time to spare after they say a woman drove her car into a Philadelphia River on Sunday. The vehicle was going under fast with the woman still trapped inside. As Christy Aletto reports, they managed to pull her out just in time.
I was able to swim there easily, but then I couldn't open the doors.
Dramatic images of Joseph Wenzel and two other Good Samaritans trying to rescue a panicked woman trapped inside this sinking vehicle in the Schuylkill River.
I didn't want to open the front door because it was already going underwater. I yelled for the woman to climb to the back. I tried to open the back, but everything was locked and it wouldn't come undone. I banged on the windows with my hands, but couldn't break it.
Break the window.
Another man was coming over. He was swimming over to help as well, and he goes to the front and he was yelling for her to climb to the back. And a third man jumped in with a tire iron.
Here, come on.
I was able to hoist him up onto the back of the car, and he was able to bang the glass out of the back of the car.
Relief on the river shoreline as the driver, who witnesses say deliberately drove her car into the water, is hauled out of the vehicle and brought to safety by a dragon boat passing by.
Literally, as soon as she got out, the car went under.
Wenzel says he was on Kelly Drive when he saw the sinking vehicle and the growing crowd.
She was terrified. She was scared. She was crying.
It's not immediately clear what prompted the incident. The police department's dive team made several attempts to locate the vehicle, but called the search at sunset. As for Wenzel, he happened to be at the right place at the right time.
I just think it's what anyone would do.
The woman was taken to the hospital for observation after her rescue. Police have not said if she drove into the river intentionally or not.
Six people are dead following a plane crash 65 miles north of San Antonio, Texas. Today, the Texas Department of Public Safety says the incident occurred near the town of Kerrville at 9 a.m. The Beechcraft BE-58 twin-engine plane was preparing to land at Kerrville Municipal Airport when the accident happened. Wreckage was found 6 miles north of the airport. The Federal Aviation Administration went to the scene immediately, and the National Transportation Safety Board will be in charge of the investigation.
Immigrants are now being detained by a militia group posing to be Border Patrol. Video shared on the group's Facebook page of members detaining migrants at gunpoint and caused widespread attention. The group, known as the United Constitutional Patriots, say their efforts will not stop until the wall proposed by Trump is built.
13 people were killed in a shooting attack in the Mexican state of Veracruz on Saturday. Authorities say gunmen opened fire at a bar during a family party. One of the victims is said to be a young child. Four others were wounded. CNN learned today the attack was carried out by the Jalisco New Generation Cartel. According to the investigation, a search is still underway to find the gunman who fired on the gathering.
Investigators believe the catastrophic 9-hour fire that engulfed Notre Dame Cathedral less than a week before Christianity's holiest day started at the center of the cathedral's roof. Omar Jimenez is in Paris on this Easter Sunday with the very latest.
Easter in Paris this year means just a little bit more. On a day that for Christians is about resurrection, there maybe has never been a symbol more clear nearly a week after a devastating fire that nearly brought down the entire Notre Dame Cathedral.
It's an Easter in Paris against a backdrop no one could have imagined, one without Notre Dame. Cristobal Ochoa is a photographer and took these pictures as the iconic cathedral spire came crashing down.
I saw a lot of people crying. It was very contagious crying because I wanted to cry too. Actually, I look around and I see people of all religions watching and feeling bad of the situation. It's not about a religion thing. It's about humans.
It's an impact that's been felt across the world, but especially in France, where President Emmanuel Macron hopes to rebuild in a matter of years. Meanwhile, the investigation into the fire's origins continues. Prosecutors have been looking at whether an electrical short circuit was to blame.
The building just got so small for a minute as the flames took over.
Jackie Gibson's pastry shop is right across the street from the cathedral.
The only time we ever go to church is Christmas and Easter, and we go to Notre Dame because that's our church. That's our church.
And it's one that's still standing, as it has for hundreds of years. But one that almost burned down in a matter of hours.
And moving forward, France is set to hold an international architectural design competition to redesign the spire that fell over the course of these flames. And even though the cathedral is still standing, it's also about making sure it is stable at the beginning of what is set to be a long road to restoration. Reporting from Paris, I'm Omar Jimenez.
Yesterday served as a remembrance of what was the soul of France. French President Emmanuel Macron hopes Notre Dame can rebuild within the next 5 years.
Coming up in sports, Brian Rutman. Brian, can you give us a quick preview?
Of course. Coming up, the Yankees continue to lose stars, and I'll bring you up to date on the Lakers softball team. All this and more coming up after the break. You're watching WTOP 10 Nightly News. We'll be right back.
We believe in patriotism. We believe in our country. For 100 years, veterans have been impacting our nation through the American Legion. Learn more at legion.org/we believe.
It's back and better than ever. One student can win up to $25 in cash. All on Oswego's favorite game show.
Say to win!
Every Sunday night at 9, only on WTOP 10 TV.
Welcome back to WTOP 10 Nightly News. I'm Brian Rudman with your Monday night sports update. Starting on the softball field, as the Oswego State softball team took the field today when they hosted Fredonia for a doubleheader. The Lakers were able to extend their win streak to 8 games with wins by scores of 16-3 and 2-1. In the first game, it was a 9-run third and a 6-run fourth that propelled the team to the win. While in the second game, a 2-run third was enough as the Lakers allowed just 1 run. With the wins, the Lakers now sit at 11-5 in conference. Now moving to the turf, as the women's lacrosse team hosted Suniac foe Oneonta on Saturday for Senior Day. It was a thriller throughout that came to an end in overtime when senior Bridget Reagan netted a goal to give the Lakers a 14-13 win. With the win, the Lakers clinch a spot in the Suniac playoffs and jump past Oneonta and New Paltz into fourth place in the standings. Headed now to the NBA, as it is playoff time in Brooklyn. On Saturday, the Nets hosted the Philadelphia 76ers for game 4 of the Eastern Conference playoff first round. Tensions were high in this one, and they reached a climax in the third quarter when Brooklyn's Jared Dudley and Philadelphia's Jimmy Butler got ejected following a shoving match started by Dudley. on the scoreboard. However, the Nets did lead through three quarters, but were outscored by 10 in the fourth, which led to the 112-108 final in favor of the 76ers. With the loss, the Nets now trail 3-1 in the series and will head to the City of Brotherly Love for tomorrow's Game 5. Moving now to the Bronx as the Yankees' injury woes continue. During Saturday's game, star right fielder Aaron Judge had to exit the game due to an oblique injury following a swing that resulted in a single. On Sunday, Judge was placed on the 10-day injured list, becoming the 13th Yankee currently on that list. But even without Judge, there was still baseball to be played yesterday. Let's head out to the Bronx to see how the Yanks fared against the Royals.
Listen, also, it comes back to burn the play.
Judge and Stanton both on the bench on the injured list for the Yankees. It was James Paxton on the mound, and he was dealing all day long. See a K there. He went 6 innings, 3 hits, no runs, 12 Ks. You see 3 of them here. He struck out 4 in a row at one point. But now it's Clint Frazier in the fifth. He's been a hero for the Yankees with all the injuries. He's going to go deep to left center, putting the Yankees up 5-0. But the Royals weren't going down without a fight. Alex Gordon in the eighth, tying up the game at 5. Adam Ottavino can't believe it. And the Royals aren't done yet. Very next batter, Hunter Dozier, goes deep to right center, putting it past the Yankees bullpen, giving them a 6-5 lead. Yanks didn't go down without a fight. Austin Romine in the eighth knocks in the tying run with 2 outs. Yankee Stadium pumped up, so is Romine. He wasn't done yet. Now in the 10th, 2 men on for Romine. Gonna blast one out to right center. This one's gonna get over the head of Billy Hamilton, plating the winning run from third. Yankees mob Romine at first. Yankees win it by a score of 7-6. They're now 11-10 on the season.
Yeah, and I'm telling you, it's tough seeing Judge go down like that with all the previous injuries they have.
Yeah, they got so many injuries. Judge just adds to it. They're going to have to really fight and really come together as a team if they're going to get through this.
Definitely, I would say so. Do you have one last look at the weather?
Anything? Yeah, definitely one last look. Tomorrow, we do have that rain moving in the afternoon into the evening, but the rest of the week, looking pretty nice.
Sounds good.
Well, that's our report for tonight. Be sure to stay tuned for What's Your Point at 10.
Thank you for watching and have a great night, everyone.
The second I got on the campus, I knew Oswego was the place to go.
There's a place for everybody at Oswego.
This school just opens the world to you. I have the opportunity to explore and to learn so many different things, not only about yourself, but the people around you and the world.
It definitely is about the student. I felt it to be very about me. Now that I'm here, I can't imagine myself anywhere else.
Everybody can make something, because I think everyone has a spark of creativity. And the reason that I have to keep making is because I don't think my life would be as fulfilling without it. If you make things yourself, that means you're not cowering in fear. You're out there taking chances. That, I think, is my way of saying I love you to the world. All right, now I want to hear why you make.
Share your own Why I Make story today. Visit whyimake.org.
I mean, they were
Do you think Bryce Harper, Tommy John survivor, Nathan Eovaldi?